Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Laura Mullen, and on behalf of ACRL and Choice, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, Library Technology Essentials, sponsored by the Roman and Littlefield Publishing Group. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from ACRL and Choice that addresses new ideas, developments, and products of interest to the academic library community. Free to users, these structured 60-minute live presentations provide the opportunity for interactive discussions of important new issues and developments in academic librarianship by librarians, vendors, authors, and other interested stakeholders. Before we get started, I'd like to point out a few features of the webinar software. In the main area of the screen, you can follow along with the presentation materials. Along the left-hand side, you will see a chat panel that you can use to submit questions or comments. We'll spend some time responding to your questions during the program, so please feel free to submit these throughout. There is a separate box for technical questions where participants can contact us for technical support, and we'll troubleshoot with them privately. And finally, please note that today's program will be recorded, and all registrants will receive follow-up instructions on accessing the archived version. Our speakers today are Tom Bruno, Amy Deschanes, Chad Haefeli, and Sarah Malden. And now over to Tom Bruno, who will get the program started.
Hi, everyone, and thank you, Laura, and thank you, everyone, for tuning in for what I think is going to be a wonderful discussion about four of these books in the Library Technology Essentials series, which is a 12-volume set. The Library Technology Essentials series is a response to changes in information consumption, new technological advancements, and growing user expectations, and a way to help librarians devise methods to remain relevant in a rapidly changing digital world. The series was edited by Alyssa Krosky, as I said, you are going to be hearing presentations from four of the 12 authors today. The way we're going to be doing these presentations is that we will do a slightly modified Pecha Kucha format, whereas each presenter will be presenting off of 20 slides, where they'll have 20 seconds roughly for each slide. We're going to try to hold ourselves to the honor system, with questions and answers to be taken by the panelists at the end of all four presentations. If people do have questions in the chat window while the presentations are going on, we've all agreed as panelists, when we're not speaking, if we see something that we'd like to answer in chat, we'll be more than happy to try to do so. Seeing that we have quite a large audience, if the questions get away from us in the chat window, our technical support folks who are helping us with this will make sure that these questions are stowed away so that we can respond to them at the end of the program. My name is Tom Bruno. I'm Associate Director for Resource Sharing and Reserves at Yale University. Since I was elected, just to say hi to Adam and everyone at University of Rochester. I know they tuned in. They told me specifically they were going to be here. So hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. I'll be going last in the four since I was selected as moderator. So first off, without any further ado, let's turn this over to Amy Deschanes. For her book, Free Technology for Libraries.
Great. Thanks so much, Tom. And good afternoon, everyone. As Tom said, I'm Amy Deschanes. I am the User Experience Specialist for Harvard University Libraries. So I work with all of the libraries doing user research Prior to that, I was the Systems and Web Applications Librarian at Simmons College Library, which is where I got my experience using free technology for libraries and where I got a lot of the ideas that are in this book. So I wanted to just take a quick poll to start with to see how many of the folks in the webinar today are using free technologies. So if you have used these as part of your work in a library in the past, just go ahead and check off all that apply. Great. So I've got a few listed here. Obviously, there's a lot more. But yeah, I see a lot of people using Google Drive and Google Docs and folks using Jing, which is great. Awesome. Then about 10% of people aren't using any yet, so maybe you'll get some ideas here. All right, so just to jump in, why free technology for libraries? Obviously, most libraries are facing some kind of budget crisis right now, having cuts in resources, fundings, and need to get creative about how they can automate tasks and solve problems in a much cheaper way. And in the book, what I talk a lot about is leading with the problem, not the solution. So when you're thinking about implementing a free technology tool, think about the problem that it's going to fix. Instead of, you know, I know it's very appealing when a staff member or yourself comes home from a conference, you have a great idea, you saw another library using a free tool, but you really should think about what is best for your library and is the tool you're going to use actually solving a problem? Because you don't want to have, you know, too many systems or too many free things, or simply adopt because it's new and shiny and sounds awesome. So always lead with the problem, not just the solution because it sounds like a great idea at the time. And free isn't technically free, right? Perhaps these things don't cost any money, aren't going to be a line on your budget, but they do need, just like puppies, require care and feeding, and there needs to be someone in charge of support with these technology tools. You know, just like anything, even a paid resource, there's something you have to take care of. So think about who's going to be responsible for those things, who has the bandwidth on the staff and the knowledge and expertise to actually keep supporting these free tools that you're implementing. So now I'm just going to go through a couple of definitions very quickly. In the book, I set up sort of two types of free tools that I discuss. One is web applications or web applications. So in my definition of web application, this is something you can get for free through the web browser. Usually you just have to use an email address to sign up to get access to it. Sometimes you don't even need to create an account. So whenever I call something a web application, that's what I'm talking about. The other term is open source tools. So these are things that you would need to download source code for and usually install on a web server. So a couple of other definitions. So web server, you would need to have your own physical web server in your library or pay for hosting space through a web server company. And one of the ones that I like a lot is a small orange if you're looking for hosting space for some kind of free open source application to try out. So the next thing is you want to evaluate these free tools. Often there's a lot of different things you can pick from. So things for document sharing, shared calendars, screen sharing. There's a multitude of free solutions that are out there. So you want to list out the requirements for your organization. What features are important for these software to have? What are the priorities that your organization needs when using this particular free tool? And also make sure you're discussing it with the stakeholders who are going to be using it and the people who are going to be supporting it. I recommend doing this two-step process after you have your requirements. So first, an internal scan. So take a look at, you've got your list of requirements. These are the things we want to accomplish with some kind of free tool. Say it's managing shared documents. What do you have at your library or organization that can support this? And I mean in terms of personnel resources, like are there certain skills that the staff have that can be used in supporting this? Do you have certain people who know programming or web markup that can support an open source application? Are there folks with previous experience that'll make it a lot easier for implementing one solution versus another? And also, are there people who are willing to take training classes on some of these things? Sort of, if there are no, say, skill sets available, how can you get the training you need? So really take a look at what you have available. The second step of the process is doing some kind of external scan. So looking at all of the options that are available. So you have your requirements, you have your internal scan of what you have. Now you're going to be doing research on listservs via Google, different blogs or websites that highlight free technology to see what the different options are and consider what does the support look like for these. You know, there isn't going to be a vendor you can call to ask questions. Is there a listserv? Is there a Google group? Are there people actively working on it if it's an open source application? And also, what's the documentation like? Is it easy to find an answer to your question, or is it something that's taking a really long time? So that's the external scan. So once you have those three things, the requirements, the internal scan of what you have available at your organization, and the external scan, this is how you can determine which free technology solution is the best fit for your organization. And often, there's no perfect solution, but you can get pretty close if you do your homework. So one thing I do want to mention, as with any technology, but especially free technology, it's always good to acknowledge the risk, right? Free can become not free, can become paid, can go away completely. I use the example of Google Reader, which a few years ago was what seemed like almost everyone was using for managing RSS feeds from websites. And then Google decided that they weren't supporting it anymore, and it went away, and you had to find another solution to manage your RSS feed. I did want to point out with this, the good thing is that Google gave you the opportunity to export your data and take it to another platform. So that's one thing when you're evaluating, definitely look at to sort of address the risks. Is the data you're putting into the system something you can take with you in case you ever need to move to something else, right? If something gets discontinued, you don't want to lose all the work and data you put into it. So now quickly, I'm going to go through five of the top, my opinion, top free apps that I talk about in the book. So the first three are web apps. The first is join.me. So that's the actual name of the website, join.me. And this is a screen sharing tool. And what's nice is the person who is the presenter, so say if you were using this at a reference desk to do a screen sharing session, the person who's the presenter has to have a little applet installed on their computer, but the person who is attending does not have to install anything at all and can go right through the browser. So you give them a web address and then they're viewing your screen right in the browser. This can be really powerful for demonstrating how to use a database or how to construct a specific query. Anything you want to walk someone through, it can be really helpful. The second is Zoho Creator. So Zoho is similar to the Google app suite like Google Docs, Google Sheets, Google Forms, very similar to that, but Zoho Creator is an online relational database. So if you've ever used or heard of Access, which was in the Microsoft Office suite of productivity applications, relational database, but this is a relational database in the cloud. And it will allow you to create tables, build forms, the same as any relational database, but with very little technical expertise required. And it is a great alternative to Google Forms. Google Forms is wonderful, but if you've ever felt restricted into how much data analysis you can do in a Google Sheet, I would definitely recommend checking out Zoho Creator as an alternative. The third one is W3 Layouts. W3 Layouts is an offshoot of W3 Schools and W3C, and they offer free HTML and CSS templates for building websites. So if you go to W3 Layouts, you can just download basic HTML, CSS with a little bit of JavaScript that is basically a template for a website. And they have all different types of layouts, including responsive design, one pager. So it's very modern-looking clean designs. And they actually even have one that's a public library website. So if you're looking to redesign your website and want to just start from, you know, a template, I definitely recommend checking this out. The last two I'm going to mention briefly are two open source apps. The first one is Guide on the Side. Guide on the Side is an open source application written in PHP by the folks at Arizona State University. And this is an information literacy tool. You can see it in action on the left here where it says finding ebooks in the online catalog, choose your keywords. It allows you to build these tutorials right inside the browser and include things like descriptions and little quizzes. Over on the left, you can see a question, it says check answer, that walk people through certain processes on your website. And the final tool I want to mention is Coral, which is an open source electronic resources manager. And this would require, like I said before, server space where you could install this, but is a very user-friendly application for managing electronic resource vendor records, licenses, organizations. This is something we actually moved to at Simmons from using a proprietary product, and we had great success with it and found it a lot easier to use and a lot more lightweight. So if any of these applications sounded appealing to you, I would definitely recommend keeping your goals in mind. You don't want to lose sight of your goals. No matter what you're implementing, just make sure you're reaching, you know, and you're reaching your goals, and that you always sort of do a check-in even after you implement them, that is it still working for you? Is it still worth the time and effort that you're putting in? And I'm sorry, someone just said Guide on the Side is from University of Arizona. Sorry about that. Couple other things I want to mention is considering what your business process is for supporting these. Who's responsible for what? Who's going to maintain it? Keep track of changes that come out with the free technology and be responsible for the support. And just always consider you're going to require a little bit more staff time when using free tools. Last two points I want to make are just it's really important to keep up with the technology, right? So subscribe to feeds about these solutions. Once you've implemented something, make sure you're keeping track of when there are changes or updates. And then also just being aware of sort of new trends that are coming out, both in library technology and also in sort of the wider world of all technology. So following appropriate websites on Twitter or things like that, just to keep up with sort of the inundation of all this new stuff that continually comes out. So that's it for mine. And here's my contact information. I'll be happy to answer some more questions in the chat and at the end of the presentation. So thank you.
Thanks a lot, Amy. And I have to say, I'm also in a state of mourning still about Google Reader and its untimely demise. Sheepish kind of guilty admission, I still keep the GReader app on my phone as sort of like a little tribute. And every once in a while, I'll click it and hope that it actually works. And I'm very sad when it doesn't. So changing gears, we're now moving on to our next. That is going to be Chad Hafele. So take it away, Chad.
Thanks, Tom. Hi, everyone. I'm Chad Hafele. I'm the Emerging Technologies Librarian at UNC Chapel Hill here in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. I work as part of our User Experience Department, where we maintain the website. We do a lot of user research and a lot of odds and ends. But we do a lot with WordPress in particular. So my book that I wrote is WordPress for Libraries. And before I dive into it, I've got a poll. Just a quick one, wondering how many of you use WordPress, whether yes or no, but personally, no, but you're considering it, or just flat out no, which is perfectly okay. I see responses coming in. We've got about a quarter who use it with your library and roughly another 20 or so percent that use it personally. So I'd say almost half, which is pretty good. So hopefully you'll find something new that I talk about here. And before I start my timer with my 20 seconds per slide, there's not a lot of time in these slides for me to spell out where the links are that I'm talking about, but links to everything I mention are on my website, WordPress-powered at hiddenpeanuts.com. So here's my background with WordPress. This is the UNC Libraries site at library.unc.edu. we moved our site to WordPress in 2013. Before that, we were just flat HTML files, no content management system at all. And it's been really, really good to work with. And we also, or I also, have used WordPress for my own blog for about a decade now, which is way longer than I realized it was. So why use WordPress? Why use any content management system? Because you don't want your website to look like this. Believe it or not, the Space Jam movie website from 1996 is still online in all of its wonderful glory. It actually all functions. Who knows why Warner Brothers just kept it up, but you don't want your site to get outdated like Space Jam. Don't be Space Jam. Now, there's two versions of WordPress. The first one I'm going to mention is WordPress.com. You can use this one completely for free. They host it for you. It takes a real minimal investment of technology, expertise, and skills. It's really good for experimentation and cutting your teeth on WordPress. But it does have limited customization and plugins and themes, which I'll talk about later. They're willing to sell them to you for a price, but at least at the base level, you can start for free and play around with it a little bit. WordPress.org is the more powerful version. And this is the one, I liked Amy's analogy earlier, of free as in puppies. It's free software that you can download, but you've got to find your own server to put it on. You could either have one in your library, you could use the A Small Orange service she mentioned for about $5 a month, or there's more specialized WordPress hosts like WPEngine.com, which gives you more full service and manages a lot of WordPress for you for about $29 a month. But this is the one that gives you full customization. So what do I love about WordPress? The next few slides I'll talk about things in particular. But in general, I love how flexible it is. If you're a beginner or an advanced user, you can still get a lot of use out of WordPress. It manages your content really well, puts it in an interactive form that's easy to manage, and pretty easy to tweak to your heart's content. Or if you don't want to tweak, you don't have to either, for the most part. I love the community. The fact that it's over a decade old means there's a lot of support out there on the web. If you've got a problem with WordPress, someone else had that problem before you, guaranteed, and solved it. So it's just a quick Google away. One of the main features I want to talk about is themes. And so themes bring to mind theme parks to me. So think, what if with one setting change, you could change Disney World and Universal Studios, or vice versa. You've got your content, and WordPress will apply a theme to it that formats it all nicely. It applies your consistent colors, your navigation, your branding, etc. And there are, I've lost count of how many themes there are out there. There's probably no way to count them, thousands and thousands untold of themes that you can take advantage of other designers' work. Some are free, some are paid, but a lot of them are free, and you can make your site look beautiful with a couple of clicks. One thing I want to emphasize is if you're picking a theme for your WordPress site, pick one that's responsive. Responsive design is a topic for another time, but in general it means that your website will display nicely across different device sizes. So you write your web page once, you don't have to write a separate mobile version. The theme we use here is responsive, so you see this little screenshot on the left on a desktop, and then what it looks like on a phone in the middle and on the right. We didn't have to write any extra code to do that. Our theme takes care of it for us. Short codes. I want to point this out. This is the most technical I get, I promise. But short codes are my favorite kind of unsung feature of WordPress. Basically, they're shortcuts for larger chunks of text. So anywhere that we put on our website, library hours in those square brackets, it will replace that text with our library hours. Anywhere that we type chat widget between those square brackets, it will put one of our chat widgets. Anywhere that we type building policies, it will dump our building policies. Looking at that in detail, we have a lot of branch libraries which have similar but not identical building use policies. So we want to maintain that content in one place so it doesn't get out of sync with each other and outdated. So we have one place in the WordPress backend where we type in the bulk of our building use policies. And then any branch that wants to put that on one of their web pages just types bracket building policies, close bracket, and the text that you see here will appear on their page. When it comes time to update that text, we just update it in one place, and it cascades out to all of those different pages. Really, really cool. Short codes, like I said, put the content management in content management system, the feature that doesn't get nearly enough press. And in my book, I talk about a lot of case studies of WordPress. I've talked to public libraries, academic libraries, special libraries, K-12 libraries, those examples of every type in there. Here's the Jackson District Library in Jackson County, Michigan. And you can see how they were easily able to create a featured banner at the top, how they feature their upcoming events as part of a calendar view, and a lot of this is all drag-and-drop functionality with minimal coding involved. Another example, the Vermont Library Association runs their site in WordPress, and a couple things they pointed out that they really like about it is that it provides continuity to their organization. So they don't have just one webmaster who then, you know, moves on from the Library Association and nobody knows how to run the website anymore. You can pass off the admin duties If you have someone responsible for a section or a roundtable, they can maintain their own portion of the website without having to go through that choke point of one webmaster for the site. And we do that too here. We have different librarians maintain their own stuff on the website. And one of the most impressive examples I saw was at the Durham County Library here in North Carolina. They not only run their main website on WordPress, but they also ran their whole summer reading program on it. They created a custom login system where every user gets their own account. It tracks their points from reading. They can redeem them for prizes. A really, really cool project that dives into the more advanced features of WordPress that are out there if you happen to have a developer available. Plugins are my next favorite part of WordPress. And what a plugin is, it's a little piece of code that adds a feature to your site, generally with a couple of clicks. There's over 40,000 of them in the official WordPress directory and more elsewhere from private developers who might sell them individually. But odds are, if WordPress doesn't have the feature that you want when you set it up, you can add it with a plugin, almost guaranteed. The tricky part is that sometimes there's five or six plugins that add your feature, and you've got to pick the best one. But that's a good problem to have, in my opinion. Let's look at some examples. There's a plugin called Formidable that we use to create all of our forms. It gives you a drag-and-drop interface to create different text fields to tell you what type of questions you're asking, and it keeps track of all your answers, too. So when someone submits this form for a research consultation, Formidable sends an email notification to the appropriate librarian and keeps it in a database on the website within WordPress that we can go in and look at later. So at the end of the year, when it comes time to pull reports, we don't have to go counting emails to see how many consultations requests we had come in. We can just go to the Formidable plugin and do a simple database query, a couple clicks, and it tells us how many we had for the year. Another plugin you should absolutely get no matter what you're using WordPress for is called Akismet. What Akismet does is it eats up all your spam for you. If you have comments turned on your WordPress site at all, you will get spam. It's an unfortunate reality. WordPress is really, really popular, which makes it a really, really appealing target for spammers. But on my personal site where I have WordPress running, I've had Akismet all along. It's in the decade or so I've run WordPress, it has blocked 2.1 million spam comments on my blog. And I'm not a big time blogger. I'm small potatoes. But Akismet took part of that took care of all that for me. And I think I've only manually ever had to deal with a very small handful of spam. Someone has to spell that. It's spelled A-K-I-S-M-E-T. Again, the link is on my blog. And lastly, there's a slew of plugins that deal with SEO, search engine optimization. It's kind of gotten a bad reputation as a term. A lot of spammers use it to justify how they try to manipulate Google's rankings. But there's plugins that make it really easy to organize your content in a way that Google likes. There's plugins that integrate Google Analytics in there so you can get feedback on how your pages are doing without having to wrangle the code yourself. There's plugins that give you ideas of how old your pages are, which ones need to be looked at and updated. There's all kinds of plugins that make your content management and your search engine optimization really easy and straightforward. And zeroing in a little bit on a specific plugin again, I recommend any library that uses images at all get a plugin called Media Library Assistant. I know I'm supposed to tell you how great WordPress is. One thing it does terrible at is media management. It doesn't have a lot of great built-in features for managing your images, audio files, etc. But like I said, there's a plugin for everything. Media Library Assistant lets you add tags and categories to your images, sort them in different ways, and helps us keep a handle on all of the images on our site so we don't end up with the unused hundreds of them that we had in our pre-WordPress days. My other absolute favorite thing about WordPress, like I said earlier, is the community. And you can take advantage of the development work that others have done. For example, we didn't like any of the plugins out there for displaying library hours. We've got a lot of branches, it's a fairly complicated view. So we had our wonderful developers build one for us. And we've since open sourced the plugin that anyone can use on the website. It's called Hours of Operation, or WHO. It has a little owl logo. It's very delightful. But anyone who uses WordPress is perfectly welcome to take this plugin and use it on their site. And we're not the only ones developing these by any means. I'm really hoping that a library-focused community will pop up around WordPress plugins specifically tailored toward our needs. Again, the link to that is on my site. So what's the future of WordPress look like? It powers about a quarter of the web right now. They officially have said they're targeting powering 50% of the web within the next few years, which is amazing. But based on that poll back at the beginning, it looked like about 50% of us were already using WordPress. Maybe we're a little bit ahead of the game. They're adding a full API to WordPress soon, which means you'll have even more flexibility and control over the data that you put into the site. And if you happen to have a little coding expertise, or a developer on hand, you'll be able to do extra magical things with it. But again, you don't need to have any of that experience. You can do 90%+ of what WordPress offers and get a good site up and running with just drag and drop filling out text fields. Which brings me to the end of my slightly long pseudo Pecha Kucha talk. Again, my book is WordPress for Libraries, and all of the links to everything I've talked about today are on hiddenpeanuts.com. Thanks.
Thank you, Chad. And I would just like to state for the record that I believe that Space Jam is a highly underrated movie, and it's really one for the generations. Next up on our list is Sarah Malden, who will be talking about her book. Are you ready to go, Sarah? Do we have an audio issue? Well, it looks like we're having audio difficulties with Sarah right now. We're trying to get her back on the call. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump to my presentation. My name is Tom Bruno, as I mentioned, Associate Director for Resource Sharing and Reserves at Yale University, and I'm going to be talking about wearable technology. Now, when we talk about wearable technology, as librarians, we have to be mindful of something, because I know everyone's talking about how wearable technology is the next big thing. For librarians, I think that for librarians of our generation, that sets off all sorts of yellow and possibly red flags. Are we talking about the next big thing, or are we talking about, quote-unquote, the next big thing, i.e., is wearable technology, is it QR codes, is it Second Life? And so just for fun, I fired up my old Second Life avatar and put a pair of Google Glasses on him, and now he's trying to scan a QR code. So I think we should always be mindful of that, and it's okay to be cautious when approaching something when something new and something faddish that's making the rounds. But wearable technology has been with us for quite some time. I always like to think of my archetypal example is the Greek mythical hero. No superpowers, by and large. Well, Hercules was strong, but we'll leave him out. But most of these mortal heroes, the only thing they have going for them are these magic items that the gods give them. This is a picture of Perseus slaying Medusa. And the gods gave him these cool winged sandals, so he could fly. And they also gave him a nifty shield with a mirrored interior, so that he could gaze upon the Gorgon without being turned to stone. So the idea of wearable technology is kind of hardwired all the way back into myth. But even early on, even pre-modern times, we've been trying to experiment with the concept of wearable technology. This is a slide from a Chinese abacus watch. I don't know. I'm squinting just to look at the little beads. But the idea that you could wear something which could amplify or enhance your natural abilities, we seem to have a natural impulse to gravitate towards this sort of invention, even before when we're talking about digital times. And that brings me to what is perhaps the most widespread form of wearable technology that we currently, that many of us, especially librarians, are beneficiaries of, and that is eyeglasses. Eyeglasses were basically invented in medieval Italy, and they started as a luxury item and a status symbol. But they quickly became, as they were mass produced and distributed throughout the world, they became a very important enhancement device. Already in medieval times, we were already turning to technology to assist us. Similarly, with the concept of the smartwatch, those of us who remember like the really cool Dick Tracy, talking to the smartwatch, that was sort of the idea, kind of like, the idea of Star Trek communicators, or the Star Trek pads inspiring future technology. Well, the smartwatch has a lineage that goes back to those, you can see on the far left, a medieval German timepiece that you wore around your neck, kind of like the ultimate bling. To what many of us may remember as the first ubiquitous form of digital wearable tech, the Casio calculator watch, which I have extremely fond memories of. And then finally, on the far right, the Apple Watch. Now, wearable technology, the digital form of it, really traces its lineage back to the Wearable Computing Group, which is a group of MIT Media Lab scientists and engineers who in the late 80s and early 90s started to pioneer and mainstream this idea that you could walk around with a wearable computer on your head or your body. I was actually an undergraduate at MIT and in the early 90s, and I actually remember seeing members of this group, wandered around the supermarket. So it was kind of a formative moment for me, and I mentioned that in the writing of the book. The Wearable Computing Group actually bore some very interesting fruit, because one of their group, Thad Starner, went on to head up Project Glass for Google Glass. And that's how I got really involved in writing this book when Alyssa asked me to, because my primary interaction with wearable technology in libraries was in that I had received a Google Glass invitation as one of the Glass Explorers, and like many librarians, I think, who also received similar similar invitations. I asked my library if they would be willing to purchase the item and to loan it out as part of the library collection. As you can see, this is an example taken. This was from another library that had recently purchased Google Glass and was loaning it out in a petting zoo format. So we called ours the Yale Bass Glass. We didn't actually put it on our mascot, Handsome Dan. Although I will talk about GoPro cameras and mention the fact that we did actually put a GoPro camera on Handsome Dan for commencement a couple of years ago to get a dog's eye view of how things go down. But what we did with our Google Glass is that we introduced it to our community, library staff, students, and teachers and other stakeholders through petting zoos where they could come and play with the item hands-on, presentations, where we could demonstrate the device to a larger group of people, and then we started to loan it out on a project loan proposal basis, and that's how we managed loaning it for the first year. Now we have three Glass devices, and now we currently loan all three out directly through our undergraduate media equipment desk, so that we fully mainstreamed them at this point. But I think one of the things you have to be mindful, and this is true of any wearable technology, is you have to be mindful of your P's. Power is always an issue with new technology. Google Glass would routinely run down in just an hour or two of use. So be mindful and manage patron expectations about what they can do with it and what they can't do with it. Also be mindful of privacy. Even if you're having an organized event where you're showing Google Glass off in a library environment, be mindful that if you're doing this in a public space, some people may feel very anxious about being recorded, or even if you're not recording them, they'll think they're being recorded and their privacy is being violated. deal with what I call the peopleware problem. And that is to say, special wearable tech can be very finicky with certain individuals. For instance, Google Glass is very difficult to wear if you already have prescription eyeglasses, and especially if you have very thick prescription eyeglasses, it can be very difficult to use Google Glass at all. And then finally, the final P is the patron expectations. The point of wearable technology is to help introduce patrons to these things, to see what they make of these technologies. But what they're going to expect these things to behave like their iPhone or their tablet or some other slick form of consumer technology that's long since left the alpha and beta periods. So I think it's very important to help manage the patron expectations so they come away with a positive experience. Show them the potential of the technology, and it's not wrong not to highlight the limitations of it as well. But it's your goal as a librarian to help mediate a positive experience with helping your patrons play with these things. And in terms of Google Glass, and just a brief poll for everyone, if you'd like to answer, how many libraries out there do actually have a copy of Google a Google Glass device? That circulates from your collection. Adam, if you have that poll ready, or have they already answered that one? Okay, excellent. One of the things that you can do with Google Glass is there is a series of apps called Glassware, and you can help introduce your patrons to these things. All right, so you know, 1% out of 1,000 out of 1,000 participants is actually higher than I thought. So you can help your patrons by choosing the right apps. Choose apps that are going to give them a lot of bang for their buck. In terms of the apps that I've always found which were really useful, things that provide a heads up display, like there's some cycling and running apps. From Strava. There's a great app called WordLens, which does real-time translation. So there are ways to help by selecting the right applications. Another form of wearable tech that people often overlook is the GoPro camera. It is one of the most ubiquitous and successful forms of wearable tech that's available right now, and the least expensive models run you about $100 to $150. So it's something that's very easily added to your collection, and it's something that you can get into your patrons' hands very, very early on. Smartwatches were tough because I'll admit things were moving very quickly as I wrote this book, and in the time that I had actually finished the first draft of this book, the Apple Watch had yet to hit the consumer market. So there had been some Samsung Gear watches and the Pebble smartwatch out there, but the Apple Watch had not yet come out. But I think what I realized about smartwatches is that it comes down to the basic question of wearable technology. And do patrons expect wearable technology to be to be a replacement or functions they do on their smartphone, or they expect it to work in tandem with their smartphone? And I think that's the basic problem of wearable technology as a whole. And so if you are going to incorporate things like smartwatches into a wearable technology program or support in a library, you may want to consider things such as near-field communication, which can help bring the virtual to your physical spaces through giving location-based alerts. But like I said, that could work for a watch as well as it could for a smartphone. It can also work with a QR code. We come back full circle. But then on the far out there part of wearable technology is what we call virtual reality or immersive virtual reality. Some libraries have added the Oculus Rift to their library collections, and it's interesting to see what patrons are going to make of this experience, because I think when you look at the continuum of smart glasses up to something which is supposed to be augmented reality to something immersive like Oculus Rift, there's a lot of space in between, And what are patrons? Patrons want to come in and play with something they can sink their teeth into, maybe bring home, and something they can use which is tangible. And I think one of the interesting things here is Google Cardboard. Google Cardboard is for $20 of materials, and a smartphone, you can have a nice DIY moment in your library that helps patrons immerse themselves in virtual reality. That was a picture of my daughter testing out walking through a Tuscan villa using Google Cardboard. But I think we're going to be increasingly exposed to these three terms: the idea of augmented reality, virtual reality, and blended reality. Blended reality is similar to what Microsoft HoloLens, if you've seen those demos. It's not out yet, but those people playing Minecraft on their table. It's coming. And so blended reality is what I think is a very interesting prospect for libraries, because it promises the idea of real-time interaction of the virtual and the physical. So what should we be supporting as library technologists? I say all of the above. Why? Because libraries are safe spaces for patrons to interact with new technologies in a risk-free, pressure-free environment. Similar to the way that libraries buy books which may not be like the bestsellers, it absorbs the risk of buying books that you may not buy yourself, so that you can try it out. I think our role for technology should be no different. Also, libraries were dangerously slow to adapt to mobile computing. And I think wearable technology is in a similar moment where we can try to get out in front of it, or we might get steamrolled by it. Because patrons are ultimately going to drive this. If they end up wanting items or they want their library to interact with their wearable technology when it becomes consumer mainstreamed, I think then it's incumbent upon us to find out how to meet them at least halfway. And I always, this is from wearable tech to wearable baby. This is my son Mario, who was a real sport as I tromped around wearing Google Glass and trying to get a feel for it when we first acquired it for the library. But thank you for your time, everyone. And I'll turn it now over to Sarah Moulton. Are you back with us?
Yes, I am. Hello, everybody. I am Sarah Moulton. I am a little different than the other presenters you have heard from today, because I am a librarian in the private sector. I work for a law firm, and so writing this book was more for me than for anything like tenure or that kind of stuff, because nobody was going to give me tenure. So this was something that I found just enjoyable and fun. So you can do it too. All right, there's your book. So the greatest value of a picture is when it forces us to notice what we never expected to see. That's probably one of the most true statements that has ever been. And it was back in the 70s when data analysis was just really beginning with computers and all of that. And I thought that the epigraph for my beginning of my book. So I really liked it, and I think that it's something that to keep in mind while you are considering if this is for you. So here we have the cave paintings at Lascaux. These were probably the very first infographics in that they said, okay, so this thing here is a very good thing to eat. We should go hunt it. This thing here, very bad, might try to kill us. We should get away from it as fast as we possibly can. And so this was here for other people that may have been pre-literate and could tell from the picture what was going on, but didn't know necessarily what, they wouldn't have been able to read words about it. So it's really the basis of visual communication. And here's another piece. This is from an anatomy textbook of quite a while ago from France, and it shows people what they cannot see just by looking. So here are all of the parts of the human body that they knew of, and this is what they look like, and all of that. And so that gave people the opportunity to see something that they wouldn't normally have had the ability to see. So now, on to some examples. So this is a data visualization. And a quick note, every infographic is a data visualization, but not every data visualization is an infographic. So, and most of what I'm actually showing you today is data visualization, and most of what you'll want to do is probably going to be more visualization, but there's lots of tools to do all kinds of things. This is showing immunization rates throughout the world. So how quickly can you tell how well people are immunized and where we're lacking and where nobody seems to be concerned? Greenland doesn't look like they're concerned about immunization because there isn't any data. So this is one. This was made using StatPlanet from StatSilk. It's a project in the book that you can look through. And then here is one of my case studies. This was done also by a private sector librarian, and she was attempting to show her funders, her bosses, all of those people, exactly what it is that the library does, where most of their work comes from. So she was basically attempting to solve a problem. Kind of like Amy said, when you need to solve a problem, look for the problem, don't look for the solution to begin with. So she decided she would do this. She's an excellent user of Excel. This was done completely in Excel and then placed into PowerPoint, which is something you can do without ever going and finding any other information or any other tools other than what's already on your desktop. And this is another one of the projects in the book. This is Creately. And Creately makes amazing flowcharts and other fabulous things. And it is, here it's being used to do a library website redesign. And so you see we can have things that are hidden, that are underneath things, that are other ideas, things that we might want to move. And this is something that you and your group can work together on. You can collaborate on this and also write notes and do all kinds of other things that will help you to get together on what it is you're doing. This is great, especially if you are in a situation where you're not all together. And then here's another one that is fascinating and wonderful, and I think the idea of it has been broken down a little by the somewhat bad word of brainstorming. And here it is using something called MindMeister. So this is mind mapping. And as you see, you can use lots of color. You can take each of your ideas, give it a child idea, give it additional children. So we have grandchildren. We can marry up Crochet and J.D. Williams. And when we do that, we can also be sharing, collaborating, having other people do stuff. And one of the coolest things about this is that it actually gives you a place to park stuff. You can undo some of these and let them park over where they need to be. Because, you know, maybe it was a great idea, but it doesn't really fit here. So this is what was basically for a library programming idea. And this is one of my absolute favorite infographics of all time. This is really the only true infographic you're going to see. I work with a lot of people who may not always remember exactly how a law gets made, even though they are JDs and attorneys and, you know, work in a private firm. Sometimes they ask things like, so it's passed the Senate, does that mean it's going to, is it already a law? Well, no. And this is kind of how the sausage is made, and it is a beautiful way to see something using color, using form, using arrows and all of that, exactly how something works. That you now have a really fast, grasp of exactly what it is that's going on with a law or a bill as it goes through Congress. This is not Schoolhouse Rock. It's not anywhere near as easy as Schoolhouse Rock made it sound. So, what can you do? That's the big question. Many people are going to say something like, but I'm a blank librarian. This doesn't apply to me. Well, it could apply to you in just about any way. So you just need to think about it. You might go, I'm not very tech focused. I don't know what I want to use this for. But anyone can use these tools and make something amazing. They are very easy to use. Almost all of them are available for free, and are and also have paid versions. But you can do it. And if you get thinking about it, you will begin to come up with ways that you can use this, because everybody has a story. And your library, just like you, has a story to tell. That means that you need somebody to know something. Maybe it's your funders, your dean, your board of directors. Any of those people may need to know something, your patron, about what it is that your library can do, what you are doing, what is used for this, and just to tell a story, because what do? We are a storytelling people, and as librarians, we deal with stories, right? That's what we really are thinking about, is how do I help somebody find this? How do I take care of this issue? How do I help somebody find a story and maybe tell their story? So here are the things that I used in this project. And they go from things that are already on your desktop, most likely, like Microsoft Office, to things that are completely free, like DataFerret and Timeline.js, to Pictochart and Easley, which are both really excellent options for making infographics, MindMeister for doing your mind mapping, Capsules and Timeline.js for timelines, Creately for making those really cool pieces of visualization of a process, as well as the ones that are very nice for making maps and other ways to visualize the information that you have at your fingertips. So also data. So it depends on what you're trying to do. If you want to talk about things that are too big for most people to think about, you need data like from the UN, or you need things from your state. How many people have a library card in my state? And also, the biggest thing here is your own data. That is probably the biggest thing you can use, and so we will use it for teaching, for learning. Maybe you need to show somebody, like your stakeholders, how important it is that this project keep working, that you keep using it, because here are all of the things that it's doing for somebody. And apparently I'm really, really close to the end of time, so here we go. Also for advocacy of anything. This could be your own cause. This could be asking your legislature or whoever for more funding. Keeping something going that you would like to keep going. There's an excellent case study in the book with a librarian from Wilmington, North Carolina, who did an amazing advocacy for library funding infographic. Also, it's about storytelling. What's the story? Who needs to learn something? Who needs to know? What do they care about? How is it? What in your mission is going to come from this story? It's also great for process. So redesigning your website,
figuring out programs, collaborating with other people, and for understanding. Everybody has an easier time understanding things when they see them visually, usually. What does your constituency need? How can you help them understand something better, like where they can go to register to vote, something like that, that is pretty basic. Using visualizations wisely and well is a big deal. Know your story, find the right tools, hunt around for inspiration, think about, do I really have time to do this? And then keep trying. And don't procrastinate. This was one of my biggest issues, was procrastination. And so that was a big deal. And also, if you're using a new tool, think about the learning curve. Think about the things that are going to keep you from using it as well as you can and making something you're not quite as happy with. And finally, you can do it. There is absolutely nothing stopping anybody on this call from doing this. If you were capable of logging in today, you can find a tool. Keep looking for new ones. Try them out until they work for you, until you find one that is your fit for your story and for your comfort. So you love Excel? Great. Go make a great Excel thing. You love finding new stuff? Go looking. And also just take a look at things like Pinterest and other places where people have really cool stuff everywhere. They're everywhere. So please, I hope that you take this as a rousing call to go out there and do it. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah. If you're minding the time, we are reaching. I guess we call this we're reaching the final countdown. Good news, we're willing to run over for about 5 minutes for some questions. So I know we have a couple of questions that we'd like to answer that haven't been fully answered in the chat. I'll turn it back over to Laura. So we'll start with the question from Kelly Faulkner for Amy. Can you make suggestions for feeds or sites to keep up with new technologies?
Sure thing. So I did add a link to the chat with a few of my favorites, both ones that are specific to libraries and also to the wider world of all technology. Just two I want to mention quickly. Our free technology for teachers has a lot of great profiles of different free tools. And the other one I would highly recommend checking out for general technology news is the New York Times and just following their technology section. I get a lot of ideas and tips from there.
Great. Looking at the parking lot of pending questions, there were some questions for Sarah about where they can find the how our laws are made infographic. Everyone really loves that, and they want.
Yeah, it is probably one of the coolest things I've ever seen. It is easy to find. Just start go out and look at it on the internet. When you get your recording, you'll be able to kind of blow up, and at the bottom, it'll actually tell you who made it, and when you do that, you will be able to go out and find a whole lot of other stuff he's done, which is really awesome. And that was you. That's a professional. I'm not sure what tool he used, but it is an amazing, amazing thing that I use all the time when I teach people about the basic political system.
And what was the infographic tool that you'd mentioned as well?
Oh, the infographic tools that I have are PictoChart and Easley are the two biggest ones, but there are many out there in the world, so just do a search for infographic tools. And somebody else had a question that data visualization, is it just the more raw version of data made visible? Yeah, it's where you have taken your data and turned it into something that's visible, but an infographic is where you've actually done a little bit more curation and made it something that people can look at and get something. Maybe it's funny, maybe it's instructional, who knows, but it is just taking that data, visualizing it and then making it yours.
Thanks, Sarah. And before I turn it over to Laura, I do want to explicitly thank the Northwest ILL Conference and the Portland Community College Sylvania Campus Library for allowing me to, through setting up a space for me to moderate this. I'm on the road, and when I agreed to this, I realized I had a panic attack that I wouldn't be able to be able to do this. But thanks to all of them, they made this possible. So special thanks. And thanks to the ACRL Choice, and thanks to Roman and Littlefield, and I'll turn it back to you, Laura.
Great. Thank you, Tom. Well, I'd like to give everyone a virtual round of applause for spending time with us today and sharing some great information. We greatly appreciate the insights of all of our panel members. As a reminder, we have recorded today's program, so please be on the lookout for a follow-up email from ACRL and Choice that will include instructions on accessing the archived version. Thanks again to all of our participants. I hope you enjoyed the session. Please have a great rest of your day.